This program is presented by University of California Television. Like what you learn? Visit our website or follow us on Facebook and Twitter to keep up with the latest UCTV programs.
Welcome to the UCSF Mini Medical School. It's my great pleasure to be here with you. My name is Ted McLeod. I'm the Chief of Orthopedics at San Francisco General Hospital, and we'll talk a little bit about what San Francisco General Hospital does. It's now the Zuckerberg San Francisco General Hospital. And we're here to speak with you today about a series of orthopedic conditions that are related in some way to trauma. So the question is, what is trauma? I get this all the time. And it simply stated is a injury that is severe that's secondary to an accident or physical violence. And it can result in all sorts of conditions. But in general, for orthopedics, it often causes a lot of both societal and personal problems. So these are numbers that are attributed to trauma. It's now considered a public health problem, not only in the United States, but worldwide. It's the third leading cause of death, and it's the leading cause of death in ages 1 to 44. Globally, it causes more death than TB, malaria, and HIV combined. So it's a significant problem that's frequently overlooked. In the U.S., it's associated with 150,000 deaths per year, 400,000 disablements per year, and $3.6 million hospital admissions that are greater than 7 days. And this, all in all, results in a very large amount of money that's being spent by our government, close to $12 billion, which is 6.9% of all of our healthcare dollars. And incidentally now, trauma has now surpassed cardiovascular disease as the leading expenditure in the United States. This has led to a variety of trauma systems development over the past several decades. And the idea is that we would like to decrease deaths, we would like to decrease morbidity or the problems that result from trauma. We would like to return people back to their pre-injured condition and really provide some sort of optimal quality of care. And to do this, we do this through sort of a continuum of treatment, prevention, and research. And throughout the course of our lectures, you'll get a little bit of each of these areas. Most people don't realize that the Bay Area has a very special place in trauma care. It was one of the two places in the country where trauma care evolved, both here and in Baltimore, Maryland. At San Francisco General Hospital, it was in one of the early pioneers in trauma care. It was one of the first indigent care organizations in the United States. It had one of the first emergency medical systems. It was one of the first teaching institutes. It had arguably the first trauma center in the country, and the Orthopedic Trauma Association, which is near and dear to our hearts, I'll mention that in a little bit, was also founded here in San Francisco. And part of this problem was because of the unrest that happened in the late 60s, early 70s, where the admissions to surgery tripled, and for trauma surgery, they went up accordingly as well. So they had to figure out better ways to kind of take care of trauma, and they did this through a series of pre to post hospital care. Now this evolved into trauma systems being developed and trauma hospitals. Level one trauma is really the highest level of care. It's academic trauma centers. There's a level two, which provides a lot of the stuff that academic trauma centers do except for the research and the educational piece. And then there's the three and the fours that are involved with lower levels of care. You can see here that the diamonds on the map are really the level one trauma centers, and they're here in San Francisco, and then there's two in the South Bay at Stanford and Santa Clara Valley Medical Center. SFGH, or ZSFG now, is the only level one trauma center in the city. So if you get hurt anywhere from the bridges down to the airport, northern San Mateo County, and you're severe, you're going to go to San Francisco General Hospital. And fortunately, the taxpayers have voted on an $888 million bill that supports the building of the new hospital, which is slated to open on May 21st. For those of you who live in the city, and it got 88% of the vote, thank you very much for that, and you should all benefit from it. But it serves about 1.5 million people. The Orthopedic Trauma Association was one of those things that evolved from San Francisco General Hospital's activity in the trauma arena. So what happened was, in addition to having trauma systems develop where general surgeons and anesthesiologists developed an area of interest in trauma and wound up staying in the hospital overnight to be able to care for people who came through, it also involved the subspecialists getting trained in trauma as well. So head and neck, neurosurgery, orthopedics, these were all areas of trauma that developed. And the Orthopedic Trauma Association, which is the largest academic orthopedic trauma association in the world, was founded in this little Vietnamese restaurant across the street from San Francisco General Hospital. So we're very proud of that. Why is orthopedics important for trauma center? Well, orthopedics, as many of you are aware, really deals with bone and joint injuries. And half of the motor vehicle accidents are a result of hospitalized injuries are a result of extremity injuries, about 20% from the motor vehicle accidents and about 20% from industrial accidents, and 12% of in the country of all disabilities are related to some sort of limb trauma, residual limb trauma. So this is a big deal. Now, how big a deal? I'm going to give you some more numbers. About 19 million injuries result in disability annually, or 564 million days per year of work lost, 147 million work days, and 21.2 billion school days are lost each year, secondary to musculoskeletal injuries, at an annual cost of about $26 billion. Half of the workers who sustain an injury do not return to work in the first 6 months after injury, many of whom also have to feed their families. About 600,000 fractures a year, or at least 10% of the fractures, go on to some sort of non-union. And this total cost is over $300 billion. So the Orthopedic Trauma Institute, which is now centered at the Zuckerberg San Francisco General Hospital, who are we and what do we do? So our mission statement is to mend the injured, inspire innovators, and empower leaders to restore lives. And I believe that's what makes us an institute and not just a center of excellence for care. We do a lot of different things, and you're going to be hearing a lot of these things during the course of this mini medical school. Much of it's focused on the clinical. We cover all the orthopedic subspecialties, and there happen to be 8 of them. Trauma is one of those. Physical medicine and rehabilitation, podiatry and orthotics and prosthetics, and at least 3 of those are really important, critical components of orthopedic trauma. We do a lot of education, both for students, residents, fellows, visiting people coming. About a third of all the training at UCSF happens at the Zuckerberg San Francisco General, including in the orthopedic department. We have a surgical training facility, which is the only one in the University of California system, that trains over 1,000 healthcare providers a year, and it's been open for the last 10 years. We've trained over 10,000 people. It's a tissue-based lab that teaches surgeons how to operate. And then we have a really robust research facility that is highlighted by our molecular biology lab. And Dr. Bainey will talk a little bit about a scientist's perspective of that today. But we, because orthopedics is very structural, we also study biomechanics. We also study clinical research programs. And we have a procedure-based lab that works through our training facility where you can use cadavers instead of humans on looking at very basic operational things. So it's a very robust approach. And then we do a lot of international and local outreach. So this is the way we put it together. It's harder to see from the back, but basically we now staff about 7 places in the Bay Area that are all trauma-related. Our services are highly desired. We inspire innovators through our basic research labs that are all interacting with each other on a very integrated way. That map there you see is the world map that's in red. Basically, those are all the people that either visited us or we visited them since 2009. So we've had a lot of reach. And we have a lot of integrated programs, both regionally and internationally. Our full-time faculty, we now have almost 20 full-time faculty that cover the whole range of these different medical conditions that I've talked about, and we have 4 research faculty. And many of these individuals you're going to hear from during the course of this mini medical school. There's a web page for those of you who are interested when you leave here to read a little bit about us, maybe between classes. That could be your homework. So we have a web page. Just go to www.orthotrauma.com. It'll pull that up. There's a lot of videos we tell our stories through, and we have some social media that you can look at. So this is the course of our mini medical school. It's listed in your syllabus. Today we're going to be talking about bone healing. On the 17th, we're going to be talking about how fractures are treated. On the 24th, we talk about upper extremity injuries. On the 31st, we're going to talk about fractures in an aging population. On the 7th, we're going to talk about amputations and living with limb loss. And then the last session of our course is going to be about bone injuries across the globe. And today, I'd like to introduce to you Dr. Chelsea Bainey. Dr. Bainey studied her undergraduate work at the University of Colorado in Boulder. She's somewhat uniquely trained among orthopedic researchers, because in addition, after she graduated, she did some work for industry in research development for Covidien, also in Boulder, Colorado. And then after that, decided she wanted to try her hand at basic research and got a degree, a PhD in cell and developmental biology at the Oregon Health Sciences University, and did her PhD in cartilage biology, specifically looking at how to build scaffolds for articular cartilage defects or joint cartilage defects. She became interested in some of the work that we've done here at the Orthopedic Trauma Institute, where we're trying to build a lot of these tissue engineering strategies for healing bone, and that we've developed a novel mechanism that she may talk about today, where we're trying to actually, instead of building bone through bone, build it through their natural course of cartilage. And so her work has been really novel and pioneering in that way. So without any further introduction, thank you again for coming. I look forward to interacting with you all. So thank you.
All right. Well, thank you. I wanted to thank you all for coming. It's so exciting to see so many people here and see people interested in a topic which I am so passionate about. And it's exciting to know that other people might care, too. I also want to thank Dr. McLeod for his excellent work in putting this course together and thank him for inviting me to speak. So as he mentioned, the first talk is going to be more of a basic science. Well, both of these talks are basic science lectures to get you primed for understanding some of the clinical work is to follow. And what we really want to emphasize is how the work we do on the benchtop is hopefully going to translate into pioneering technologies and new treatments that can mend lives and make people's lives better. So I wanted to emphasize why we do research on bone. Dr. Miklow highlighted many of the numbers that are so important, but you can see here there are 15 million fractures a year. This is the number of trauma patients I have. And here's some pretty amazing numbers. 1 in 4 adults will have chronic disability. And then that number goes all the way to 3 in 4 adults by the time you're over 65. So here are the numbers, the burden of disease. Dr. McLeod said these same things, but we've now surpassed circulatory issues or cardiovascular disease as the leading healthcare cost burden. And what's interesting is, despite this these numbers that show really the burden of disease for orthopedic and musculoskeletal injuries, we are one of the few, have one of the lowest levels of funding. So I want to bring this up because I want you to all understand how research is funded. And so I'm going to have a few slides that talk about that. But you can see the NIH, which is where a lot of the research dollars that fund basic science research come from, is really focused on a lot of other diseases, and we get sort of a small portion of the pie. So most bones heal. You all know that. How many of you have broken a bone? Hands. That's about right. And for those of you that didn't raise your hand, I've broken about 10, so I make up for a few of you. But the good news is most fractures heal. 80 to 90% of bones heal well, and you won't even know that they were injured. You won't feel any residual pain. It's especially true. This is actually my office mate's daughter who broke her arm this year, and she's so adorable. But she healed in like 3 weeks. They barely even needed to cast it. So we heal really well. When we're young, we heal very robustly. But 10 to 20% of our fractures won't heal. If you have a combined injury to the vasculature, that number is almost 50% of the fractures will have delayed healing. Dr. McLaw also brought up the statistic that 50% of people with fractures won't return to work within 6 months. And then there's a number of reasons why you might delay your bone healing. And as you age, we don't heal as well. If you have a very severe injury, you might not heal as well. Smoking decreases healing, diabetes, infection. These are all problems which might put you into the group of people that don't heal well. So research is really key to improving the outcomes from the basic level that we're at right now of 10 to 20% of fractures not healing. So we want to understand the basic mechanisms and the clinical research behind how bones heal so that we can improve these outcomes. And we do this as was just described by doing basic research, translational research, which means getting it from the benchtop into the clinic, clinical research, which is looking at patient databases to understand what has historically happened, training and education. We have a white background for some reason here, but this is just an idea of how research gets funded. So as I said, the NIH is our primary place for funding research, basic research. So without the NIH, discovery would not happen, and that's very true. Industry is a very important player in translating the discovery into clinical treatments. But you can see here they put a very small amount of money into basic research. So these two systems have to work together in order to really develop novel and therapies that have the potential to change our outcomes. So just kind of wiping our tears again. This is how the amount of money that we get in musculoskeletal research relative to some of the other diseases. And I also want to highlight how effective the NIH is. So the money that goes to the NIH, 85% of it leaves the NIH to actually fund basic research. There's only 16%, less than 16%, that goes to management. If any other private companies could be that efficient, it would be really amazing. So they really put very little into management, and the vast majority of the dollars either go to funding outside the NIH or intramural research, which is research that's done in the NIH. So why is research so expensive? I've got to imagine that many of you are thinking that. But it is a process. It's a big process. We start on the bench, and we do we look at cells, and we look at this is some biomechanics on some tiny bones. And here's a picture of our illustrious leader looking at the microscope. And so it takes all of these efforts and expensive work here to get to the bedside. And this you might have seen in the news recently. This was a recent, the first of its kind elbow transplant that was done here at UCSF. And so this is a patient. And you can see it on the UCSF website. It's a really amazing story. So this is a slide that I am adapting from some colleagues at the University of Iowa that I recently saw that really helps explain why research is so expensive. So you start in vitro, and this can be at cells, matrix, genetics, biomechanics, and that's not that expensive. But you wouldn't want to go take that information into the clinic. That would just be too big of a leap. So you might want to get in vivo, so in what we would call preclinical models, to try to understand how the whole organism might influence healing. So it's not just one cell alone that is going to lead to, the end cure. It's a lot of cells working together. So you have to understand that in a biological system. And so this gets a lot more expensive. And maybe at that point you would feel comfortable going into a clinical trial and seeing if that new idea works. But to really feel comfortable, you'd want to run a clinical trial. And these become hugely expensive. And UCSF is one of the leaders in running clinical trials. But taken together, these three steps together is what we call evidence-based medicine. And so when you put these things together, you can feel comfortable taking the research that we're finding on the bench and translating it to the bedside and knowing that we have developed an effective therapy. So bone repair, what have we learned from research? I'm going to talk about three ideas that have made an impact on the way patients are treated in the clinic. The first one is understanding what the source of stem cells are that heal a fracture. The second is building a better bone graft. And last, some basic science behind why the elderly don't heal as well. So just to review the very basics of the long bone, because that is one of the major extremities that is injured in trauma, it's the area we focus on, and it's a good example. We use the tibia for most of our research, but you can see here the bone, and then you have the bone marrow cavity. We call this the spongy bone in the top, and then this is the cortical bone in the diaphysis. If you look in here, this is very well vascularized, and that's key to its ability to heal and be a viable living remodeling organ. Another tissue that I'm going to point out, I think it's over here, is the periosteum. This is kind of a sheath that wraps around the bone. And I think those are the majority of the tissues I want to point out. And then I also want to talk about how many different cells there are in here. So just bone in and of itself, so this is inside of that bone. You have osteocytes, which are the mature bone that are interconnected and communicate with each other. You have the osteoblasts here. Blasts here in blue, which build the bone, and the osteoclasts here, which are in red, which are responsible for remodeling the bone. Inside the marrow, you have all of these cells, and suffice it to say, these are all of your immune cells, so your red cells, your white cells, your T cells, new cells we're just discovering called osteomacs. You have skeletal stem cells in there, so the cells that make bone and cartilage are inside the bone marrow. You also have the blood cell progenitors, or the hematopoietic stem cells, which give rise to the red and white blood cells down the line. Then you have cartilage here on the ends of your bone, the chondrocyte. And what I don't have a picture of here is the muscle, and that is supposed to be a muscle cell, and also the stem cell. So you can see there's a number of different tissues that all are interplayed in the orthopedic or musculoskeletal system. So what are the stages of fracture healing? It starts, stage one, is an inflammatory response. So when you break a bone, it typically is going to rupture it's usually going to break through that whole bone. You're going to expose the bone marrow cavity. You're going to rip the soft tissues, the muscle, all around it. And this is going to create a hematoma that's responsible for containing all of the bone debris and fracture debris and sort of sealing off all the blood vessels and keep you from bleeding. The inflammatory response is very important to initiating the healing, and I'm going to come back to this. The next stage is actually forming a cartilage callus. So in this picture, this is histology, which is the microscopic way that we look at tissue, and this red staining here is cartilage. And so what is interesting is even though you're eventually making bone, you start with this very robust cartilage callus formation. That cartilage then becomes remodeled into bone, and here you can see that it's becoming wavy, the red or the cartilage is going away, and in between is the creation of the vasculature. So as this gets remodeled, you eventually end up with, this is the bone here, and this is the bone marrow space. So this weavy bone that resembles the spongy bone in the end of your long bone eventually gets remodeled into the cortical bone, just like it does in development. So if you, unless you are very skilled at radiography or looking at an x-ray, you won't be able to even see where the fracture is healed. It will be indistinguishable from the native tissue in both form and function. So we study this, which is a human bone fracture, in models of orthopedic injury. And this is a picture of a mouse tibia that's been broken. I highlight where the fracture is here. And you can see that the process is the same. And that is why we have to use this model, because we need to understand all the components that we talked about earlier, the inflammatory system, the biomechanics. And what you get is this cartilage callus. It gets remodeled and turns into bone. So this process is called endochondral bone regeneration, or indirect bone healing. And basically what that refers to is just the fact that it goes through a cartilage intermediate. It's indirect process to forming bone. This is the way that the majority of fractures heal. And it's also the way the majority of bones in the body develop. So you also can get direct bone formation. So here is a picture of this kind of Russian torture device looking thing called an Elizarov fixture. And these are still used, amazingly enough, quite frequently. This is our model of the Elizarov fixture. And what's interesting about this is when you have this bone in these Elizarov fixtures, they become very stabilized. So there isn't the same amount of loading that you would see during a joint normally. And so here we actually skip the cartilage. Here we don't see any of the red in the previous picture. This is just showing that even at a gene level, we don't see any cartilage cells. And instead, we only see a bone response. So this healing is called intramembranous. Sorry, it got cut off at the bottom, but it's called intramembranous healing, or direct bone formation. This process is involved in all healing. There always is a bit of intramembranous ossification, or direct bone healing, but the majority of fractures have a pretty robust cartilage. But what's important is that we have these two models in the lab so that we can understand the two different processes and compare and contrast between them. So as I mentioned, we wanted to understand who were the stem cells that heal a fracture. Is it coming from the bone marrow? We know that's a huge source of the stem cells I talked about earlier. Is it a circulating cell that gets mobilized to the site of injury and comes in to heal the bone? Or is that stem cell in the bone itself? And really, there weren't any answers until a very interesting experiment that was done in our laboratory and published in 2009. And what they did is they took this bone, and they took what's called, it's a reporter mouse. And what that means is it's a mouse that's genetically labeled. And in this case, all the cells in this mouse's body can be stained blue. So we took some of the periosteum. Do you remember I described that was the outer lining of the bone? We took a little chunk of periosteum and we transplanted it onto a mouse that wasn't blue and then made a fracture right next to that. And so the question was, were those the source of cells that led to fracture healing? And what you can see here, here's the two ends. This is where the fracture was made. These are the two ends of the bone. And this is that robust cartilage healing response that I showed you earlier. And if you zoom in on the microscope to this area and you now look to see which cells are blue, you can see that every single cell in that cartilage callus is blue, and that those blue cells go on to give rise to the bone. So what's very important is that people previously and still think that circulating cells or bone marrow-derived cells are the source of cells that heal the fracture. It's not true, and we work really hard to educate our residents of that so that they can make better decisions in treating their patients. So for example, it used to be common practice to scrape the periosteum off the bone so that your bone plate would fit better, and so that your two ends of the bone could fit better together. And so really understanding the biology has made them recognize that that's not a good clinical practice, and that they've revisited clinical practice based on some of those decisions. Now there's some exciting research that's going forward too, where here, if you can see this is a defect in the bone. I highlight it in the red circle. People are now doing some surgeries where they try to elicit a reaction from that periosteum, or they even transplant the periosteum around that defect to help provide the stem cells that are the source of normal fracture healing. So this has made it into the clinic already. People have revised their clinical practice. This is an area of research that I think will make a difference going forward in these big defects that wouldn't heal on their own. Okay, so coming back here, developing a better bone graft. This is actually some of my research that Dr. McLeod was mentioning earlier, and I want to talk about why you would need a bone graft. So this, even if you're not in orthopedic surgery, you can look at these two pictures and tell that something's wrong. This is a fractured and dislocated spine. This is a large defect, and as I mentioned earlier, you can only have a fairly small defect, like a fracture, for it to heal on its own. Once you get bigger than 2 centimeters, generously 2 centimeters, it won't heal on its own. And in that case, you have to put something else in. So what the orthopedic surgeons will do is put all this hardware in to mechanically stabilize the system. And then they'll put a biologic reagent in there to help stimulate healing. So in many cases, this is a bone graft. And the idea is put some bone there to try to help bridge the defect. So in addition to the spine, in spine, what happens is to try to stabilize it, they put the bone graft between the 2 vertebrae and fuse the spine. I'm sure you've heard of people who have had a spinal fusion procedure done. That's what it is. But in addition to these two things, there's a number of different clinical indications that call for bone grafting. So many so that 2.2 million bone grafting procedures are done annually, and a very conservative number is that that is an $80 billion, with a B, market. That surprises me all the time. So how is this normally done? The gold standard way is to use autograft. So that's taking a chunk of bone from your hip and transplanting it to another area to help heal your bone. It actually works pretty well, but there's a number of problems. You can imagine you can only take so much of your hip before it's going to be problematic. It causes pain in 20 to 40% of the people, and pretty significant hip pain. It also leads to longer operating times. You can imagine if you're trying to fix your back and you have to go in and operate on your hip, it will significantly increase the time. So people use allograft, which is basically cadaver bone. It comes in a number of different forms, but it doesn't work that well. It has up to a 35% failure rate, which is not acceptable for anybody that's trying to mend lives. And the reason it fails is because the bone graft doesn't vascularize. I told you that the blood vessels were really important to the bone graft, or to bone living. So without the blood vessels, it will just die. And it also doesn't integrate well. You can see here there's a lot of different particles. So getting this new bone to integrate with the original bone, which is key to function, has been really problematic. So we came up with this idea that could we start with an osteochondral progenitor, or mesenchymal stem cell, which we'll talk about quite a bit in the next lecture. And these can become both cartilage and bone. So my whole PhD, I worked on turning this into cartilage, and we were trying to mend articular cartilage, which is the joint cartilage. And people have been trying to turn these into bone to heal bone. However, this doesn't work very well. And instead, these cells go on to become these really enlarged hypertrophic chondrocytes that you see in the growth plate during development. So these things are great at promoting bone formation and vascularity. So I spent my entire PhD process trying to inhibit this process. And then when I got here, they said, well, that's what it's doing. Let's just go with it. It makes a ton of sense. Why fight nature? So we did that, and we said, let's take these cells and put them in the bone and see if we can get a bone and a highly vascularized bone out. And lots of years of research and much labor later into one little tiny slide to say that it worked. What we did as a proof of concept is we took that fracture, we took cartilage out of the fracture callus, we isolated it under a microscope, we transplanted it into our model of that segmental defect, and after 4 weeks, we see this lovely piece of bone that's integrated here, and importantly, it's very vascularized. So this is a picture of that woven bone we talked about earlier. The bone is in blue, and then all the blood vessels here are stained in black. So it's highly vascularized. It was well integrated. We were really excited. If we did biomechanics on it, we found that it works as well as the autograft that we talked about earlier. And look at this. This is how often the allograft or the cadaver bone fails. So we were as good as the gold standard and so much better than the allograft. So right now, very excited because we just got a grant from UCSF Clinical and Translational Science Institute called the Catalyst Award. And this grant is designed to help us get this idea out of the bench and into a product. So we're working on taking cartilage and turning it, this is a little tiny piece of cartilage graft, and we can turn it into a number of different forms because surgeons, depending on where the injury is, like to have these in different forms. So we have strips, we have kind of this powder, or we have this gel, and we're trying to work on a way to get this into the clinic, and we think that it has a lot of potential, so I'm really excited about that. All right, so I'm going to go on to our last topic, which is why fractures in the elderly don't heal. This is just a graph confirming what we already knew. We did a lot of research and used to look at a time course of healing in mice to prove here, this is our way for quantifying bone healing. And this stands for total volume, CV is cartilage volume, BV is bone volume. And in all cases, the green line is how healing happens in juvenile. These gray bars are your standard adult, and then red is in an elderly mouse population. And what you can see is that these curves are all shifted to your right, indicating that there's a delay in healing. So the cartilage forms later, the bone forms much later. So this is confirming that there actually is a biological underpinning to the fact that we have noticed elderly don't heal as well. But now that we understood this, we have a really great mechanism model for asking why. And so I want to introduce two really clever techniques that you can use to try to figure out why in juveniles or kids you heal well and why in elderly you don't. And so recently there's been a surge of people have been bringing back this experimental procedure called parabiosis. It started about 150 years ago. I like the term share and share alike. So basically what people do is you join the vasculature or the blood system between two different animals. And in this case, you can take an old mouse and join it to a young mouse and try to understand how the two blood systems are influencing this. A similar thing you can do is you could take an old mouse and you could do lethal irradiation, which is what people do basically when they get a bone marrow transplant for cancer patients, and we can put in the bone marrow from a juvenile animal. And so you can see that in both of these cases, what we can try to understand is who is the underlying culprit for why the bones don't heal. If you join these two animals together, or if you create this, what we call a chimeric, so it's got young bone marrow in an old mouse, but if you create these systems and the old animal starts healing well, then it must be a circulating factor. If the old mouse still doesn't heal well, it's an intrinsic problem. So something in that mouse's bone, old mouse's bone, just isn't healing well. So we did this experiment, and basically what we found is that in elderly animals, there's a severe upregulation of pro-inflammatory cytokines or pro-inflammatory cells. What's interesting is that if you transplant juvenile cells, or if you do this mature elderly chimeric, it reduces all of these really high pro-inflammatory factors down back to baseline. And importantly, that leads to a restoration or a rejuvenation of healing. So what we learned from this is that it's not an intrinsic problem in the bone of the elderly mice, and presumably people, that is the cause of delayed healing in elderly. Rather, it's some circulating factor. So we've pinned this down, again, one slide to show a lot of research, to the macrophage. So the macrophage is one of the white blood cell types, and it comes in two forms. The M1, the dark side, it's a pro-inflammatory cell, or M2 is an anti-inflammatory cell, just to keep in theme with the current new Star Wars release. And this cell, even though it's one of the white blood cells, which we usually think about as involved in pro-inflammation, is actually really important to promoting healing and immune suppression. So actually being an anti-inflammatory cell, even though we classically think of it as a white blood cell. So in older fractures, diabetes, obesity, COPD, or rheumatoid arthritis, you have an upregulation in all these M1s, and people, and this is causing the delay in healing. And I'm going to come to this later in my next talk, because stem cells are an important factor in helping to create this M2 or anti-inflammatory stage. So this is one of my last slides, just to kind of show you what this means. So again, a diagram of the bone, right? When you fracture it, you get this big hematoma. The blood vessels dilate to bring in oxygen, your pro-inflammatory cells. The pH goes down, actually. You get an upregulation of these pro-inflammatory environments. And this helps to create angiogenesis. Here, cartilage is in blue and the bone is in red, and this is a diagram of, you get start to get these pockets of the cartilage formation, and the bone forms along the edges of the bone here, and you still have this hematoma. So here, the pro-inflammatory stage is essential to actually kicking off this healing. If you remove the hematoma or the pro-inflammatory environment, you'll get a delay in healing. But if you don't get the switch from pro-inflammatory to anti-inflammatory, and this is what's happening in elderly fractures and presumably these other diseases such as diabetes and obesity, you get what we call non-union or delayed in union. And so it's basically a defect in all of these events happening. So you can see that this is really important for us to understand, because now we can change clinical practice and we can try to develop therapies that help these switches happening, either pro-inflammatory to anti-inflammatory or cartilage to bone formation and happening. And so this is an active area of research in the lab, is for us to develop novel therapeutics that can potentially help people who have delayed fracture healing because they have a pro-inflammatory environment because of aging, diabetes, or any of the other chronic smoking and chronic diseases I talked about. So I'm going to finish there and take questions to talk just about these three areas. So we understand that the periosteum is the source of cells that heal bone. We think we can develop a better bone graft by starting from a cartilage intermediate, which will model development and normal healing. And we think the macrophages are the underlying culprit in why the elderly fractures don't heal well. Thank you.
So I think we have time for a few questions. Does anyone like to start?
Doctor, is nerve damage common in fractures? And if so, is nerve damage self-healing?
Well, I'm gonna start with the answer, and then I'm also gonna let Dr. McLeod answer. And you could be a famous scientist, because this is actually one of my newest areas of research, and I'm really excited to try to understand how the nerve might play a role in healing. Absolutely, all bones have nerves in them. If you break the bone, you will also disrupt the nerve. And importantly, the nerve comes in with the vasculature. So if you don't get the blood vessel coming in, you also won't get a nerve coming in. And we know that when the blood vessels don't come in, the bones don't heal as well. I'm really interested, and there's very few people who have looked at understanding how the nerve might also contribute to healing. And I am suspicious that it plays an active role, but there's also a clinical answer to that.
Yes, so one of the interesting things is if you are driving your car and you get in an accident and you have a hand injury and you break your bone, and these are very common combinations, it turns out that your bone tends to heal faster. And so we're really trying to figure out why that is. People have looked into the blood, Dr. Bainey had mentioned before, and they haven't really been able to find any circulating cells. And what we're doing right now is we're working on a system to study whether or not a head injury creates some sort of either direct or regional problem that might stimulate bone healing. So they're probably very linked in some way.
Thank you.
Another question?
Yeah,
So the question was, what determines how cartilage becomes bone? Again, very insightful question. And it was always, it's the slides are hidden. You'll see them in your handouts, but I didn't have time to talk about them today. Previously, they've thought to be totally different tissue types. And so cartilage was on the end of your bones, and it was the precursor to bone, but it was always thought that cartilage died, and basically that shell of the cartilage was replaced by bone, but the bone cells were totally separate. Very recent research from our group has now demonstrated that cartilage can turn into bone by becoming stem cell-like and then turning into bone. It's completely throwing the dogma for 150-plus years has been that cartilage dies. This is another area that's going to be really exciting because now that we understand cartilage can become bone, those cells, what we call trans-differentiate to become bone cells, we can try to develop new therapies to target that specific question. And it's now been confirmed by people outside of our group as well, and so it's a really exciting and active area of research as well.
Question in the back. The question was, what was a bone scan? And the bone scan is a study that uses a nuclear medical technique where you inject a tracer that can be picked up into areas that are metabolically active in the bone. And typically, they are very useful for certain things. People have tried, interestingly, to look at the ability of bone scans to predict whether bone heals or whether a bone is healed. The tendency is that a bone scan will light up in an area that isn't healed yet, but isn't necessarily predictive of whether or not that area is going to heal. So in that sense, it's still do that. People also will have bone scans done for areas to look at cancer, for example. So you have an area in your body that might be very metabolically active due to a cancer, and then it would show up on a bone scan. Question here? So the question was, how does pain relate to a fracture, and then how might it relate to healing? And so as Dr. Bainey pointed out, after you break your bone, you have an inflammatory process which actually causes a lot of local attraction of cells that are also painful. It's probably very protective for people to actually have a pain where their fracture was, and so we've evolved to doing that. And one of the other evolutionary components of it is we probably evolved to try to stabilize that relatively quickly. And cartilage stabilizes the bone relatively quickly. So this would help with trying to escape predators after you've broken a bone. The effect of pain on bone healing, I don't know that there's a direct effect on that, but as we sort of had touched on a little earlier, their nerves are very painful, and there's a strong chance that there's a disruption of the nerves, and that ultimately a nerve may play a role in bone healing. We just don't know what that is.
Well, I was thinking of the medication that you might give.
Sure. So that's a wonderful question. The medication, the next follow-up was, how does medication potentially affect that? So there are certain kinds of medication that are quite effective at fighting inflammation, like the anti-inflammatories. There are some very strong ones, and there are some over-the-counter ones that we normally take, like ibuprofen or naproxen. It turns out that some of those anti-inflammatories, if you give them early when the bone is trying to create an inflammatory process, you can impede healing or fusion. If you give them later, it doesn't seem to be as big a problem. So what surgeons are debating is whether or not there is, if you give, especially the more minor ones, and if you give them just sporadically, because they're very effective and they're much more effective than opioids. And we're recognizing now this national crisis that we have for addiction, that these being so effective may be useful, and we're still wrestling with the idea of how to integrate them into our clinical practice. As it turns out, most people feel relatively comfortable using some anti-inflammatories even early on during the healing phases, as long as they're not really strong and they're not overused, and in combination with some of the other things, like even acetaminophen or Tylenol, in combination with those can be very effective drugs. This is a whole area that you're going to see change in the next 5 years in terms of pain management. So it's a very, very good question. Another question here?
So the question is, any of the new discoveries unsheath old adages? Is that?
Well, yeah, and if there's a benefit to a patient who's received treatment, that would come from going back and saying we should really be doing it this way, whether it be for the spine or
something. So some new discoveries that might shed light on people who had been treated a previous way. And so there are probably a lot of those. And the pendulum in any medical field, in orthopedics too, because it's very technical, you know, do you fix a bone stably? Do you fix it with some motion? Do you try to form bone, or do you try to make it form cartilage? That has really varied a lot. You see in the popular press, we'll get into total joints at one point. They've used metal on metal. So do you use, you know, do you try to get rid of all of the inflammation that happens because you've used a plastic and you want to try a metal, but then you do that and then the metal actually causes problems. So I think we've gone back and forth, and I could probably go on for a very long time describing some things that we've done in the past, we do differently now, but other things that we've done in the past that we revisited now. So a good example of that that's related to what Dr. Bainey talked about is way back in the late 50s, early 60s, and when they're studying how bones healed, they had an idea that if you didn't fix a bone immediately, that it would actually heal better once you stabilized it. And the idea for that would be that the idea now is that there may be some substance to that, and many of the bones that we fix, we stabilize because they're in trauma patients, because we don't want the bones to move around too much. But it may these may actually be a more robust reaction. The reason for that is that you get these cells that are migrating in there, and they differentiate into some cartilage that may actually push its way to bone. So it's just an example of an old technique that can get revisited, and we can use some existing science to perhaps improve what we do. I think that is what you're asking. So let's get two more questions, and then we'll move on to the next session.
That's a good question. So the question was, does the information about cartilage becoming bone have any implications on degenerative cartilage diseases? And I think it does, because one of the problems in some of the joint diseases where the cartilage degenerates is that it actually becomes the wrong type of cartilage. So there's a specific type of cartilage that's supposed to be on your joints, and you can start to get what's called osteophytes that form, which is little chunks of bone, or it just the cartilage starts to degrade because it's not making the right cartilage. The difference is that they are two separate types of cartilage, but by understanding what can take a cartilage cell and push it to basically that graft I showed earlier where I was trying to engineer articular cartilage, if we can understand what turns cartilage into bone, again, maybe we can revisit how to prevent cartilage from becoming bone. And I think that could have a big impact on both disc degeneration and articular cartilage. We are looking at that in the lab, and the UCSF campus here is looking at that as well. But it's a very new finding, just even within the last year. And so I think it still has a lot of time to understand all the areas that it will impact. Do you have anything you want to add?
No, I thought that was very good. Last question here, and then we'll... Okay, two more questions. So let's get the question in the back, and then we'll get one in the front. We'll move on.
The question was, has cartilage been used to try to understand how to maybe engineer meniscus, if I can go ahead and... So Tissue engineering of the meniscus is an active area of research. That is also a separate type of cartilage that we haven't talked about, which is called, it's kind of a fibrocartilage. And so it is also a unique type of cartilage that has a really important mechanical role. So people have been working on engineering that. It is, that is one of the procedures that has, So people are doing the meniscal transplants that have been somewhat effective, but eventually not having the meniscus will cause your articular cartilage to degrade. And so there's a lot of interplay between those two different systems, and it is an active area of research, but I'm not sure we've made any more progress on it than that.
Yeah, but part of the problem is that all of these, especially joints or meniscus, so they're all load-bearing. And part of the big problem is actually creating the right material that would allow the cells to grow but withstand all of these repetitive loads. So that's a really big problem. The second problem is the cartilage, unlike bone, tends not to heal as well, and especially articular cartilage because it doesn't have as much blood supply, including the meniscus. And so those are all areas that are exciting, but they're a bit they're still not perfected by any means. So last question. So the question is, would creating an anti-inflammatory process in the beginning through icing or even medicine delay healing? And I believe that in the beginning, and it seems like that's what the research is showing us, that some inflammation is good. Too much for a long period of time is not good. So icing or doing things that might initially decrease the swelling and allow the joint to move but aren't really overwhelmingly problematic for your body's response are fine. And they actually make people feel better and in the long run may allow for rehabilitation to happen sooner. Good example is inflammation is important for spinal cord injury. Well, if you have an acute spinal cord injury, there's some benefit to slowing down the metabolism. And so there has been some research, even though I'm not an expert in this, but there has been some research on looking at the effects of cooling following a certain injury. Steroids used to be used a lot for these injuries as well. They're not used anymore because they have a lot of other side effects and not necessarily the same benefits. But there is a balance that we need to strike. And again, it's going to be probably figuring out the sum is good. A lot is probably not good for a longer period of time. Okay. Well, thank you all for the very engaging questions. And we'll get on to the next talk here. And if there are questions at the end, too, we can answer those that are also left over. But we did touch base on stem cells, and Dr. Bainey has a very engaging presentation on the importance of stem cells and what their roles are. And so we'll get into that right now.
Okay. Switching gears a little bit, but very much related, is stem cell therapies. And although I'm not in the clinic as much, I know this is something that our clinicians deal with all the time, is you come in with an ailment and somebody wants stem cells to fix it. And so this really started, this idea of wanting stem cells to fix everything, started, I think, a little bit with the promise of Dolly the Sheep in the 80s. But then stem cells have graced the cover of scientific magazines and our popular magazines like Time since the 80s with the promise that we're going to revolutionize medicine. And we have made a lot of progress, but I want to educate everybody a little bit better on what stem cells are, how close we are, so that you can understand some of the challenges we still have and some of the opportunities that stem cells have to actually change the way we treat our injuries. So I'm going to talk about three different areas. The title here is What Still Needs to Be Overcome. So the first issue is which stem cells to use. The second issue is, how do stem cells promote repair? And then lastly, how can we deliver stem cells to be effective for therapy? So I got these images actually off the internet, and I was amazed because they came from websites that were basically promising clinics that basically said, oh, come, I'll treat your back pain with some stem cells. Do you have a sore knee? We'll inject stem cells and cure it. So the first word of caution is that these are probably a dramatic overstatement of where we actually are. So I hope to introduce you to why that's true. Okay, so what is a stem cell? I think this is the most fundamental question that we can answer, because we use the word very ubiquitously, stem cell. It's just, there's one type of cell, it must be a stem cell. But there are so many different categorizations of stem cell, and I want you to understand what the definition is, because I think that's really important to understanding how they work. So the most, we use this word in stem cell biology called potent, which is sort of a weird word to use to describe a cell. But basically, the more potent a cell is, the more different types of tissues it can form. So a totipotent stem cell is the most powerful stem cell there is. And this is the stem cell that can differentiate into all of the embryonic tissues, so all of the tissues of a baby, but also the placenta. So this is very important distinction. So without a totipotent cell, you can form an embryo, but not the placenta that would actually support its development. There are also the placental stem cells that are a separate type of stem cell. But if you want to talk about just the cells that form an embryo, that is the pluripotent stem cell. So these are stem cells that can differentiate into all of the cells of the embryo. They're often called embryonic stem cells. They come from the very early stages of development. So it comes from this inner cell mass of a blastocyst, which is a circle. And I usually put a picture, I forgot to put it, but there's a big circle, and then there's an inner cell mass. And those cells in the inner cell mass become the embryo. So you have to take those cells to become a pluripotent stem cell. So you can also have a multipotent stem cell. These cells can differentiate into all of a bunch of tissues that are closely related. So for example, you can have stem cells that can become blood cells, skin cells, neural cells, mesenchymal or skeletal cells. Then you can have, this becomes a little bit more restricted, an oligopotent stem cell. So it can take, differentiate into only a few cell types. So for example, a hair stem cell can just make different hair cell related cells. The endothelial stem cells. So you can see that here you can form all of them, a few less. And then there's this one stem cell that's a little bit of a debate, either whether it's truly a stem cell, but the unipotent stem cell, which can only form itself or one type of cell, and that would be the muscle stem cell or satellite cell. And it's the only one that we currently classify as a stem cell, but can only make a single tissue type. Now, what's important about these is all three of these are stem cells that you can get from the adult tissue. And I don't think people really think about that. We always think about the controversy related to stem cells. But that's talking more about these stem cells, not these adult stem cells. So I'm going to focus a little bit on what both of these can tell us. So I like to use this picture to understand differentiation. So differentiation is the process of a stem cell becoming one of the ultimate cells that it's going to be. So if you're a skeletal stem cell, the process of going from a stem cell into a cartilage cell or a bone cell. And this was a Waddington's landscape that was used in the 1950s to describe development. And now it's been used to describe stem cell biology because it has a really fitting analogy. Stem cells are a potent stem cell that would be like the top of a mountain. It has a lot of potential to become all of these different types of tissues, and it can take a number of different pathways to get there. And the cell it becomes in its end state, so if it's going to become a bone cell, is a low energy state cell. So that would be like living in the valley here. And so what we need to understand stem cell biology, is how do we take these cells with a ton of potential and actually direct them to become the cell that we want them to become, so a bone cell, rather than accidentally going down the wrong path and becoming a cardiac cell or a nerve cell. And so this is a really important aspect to understand. So we know that growth factors or bioactive factors help influence what pathway you will go down. Mechanical force actually plays a really important role in understanding your pathway. And the microenvironment, so the type of tissue you're in. As you can imagine, bone tissue, fat tissue, muscle tissue have very different mechanics, porosities, basically feelings, that those cells feel their environment, and they're going to know what type of tissue they should become based on the environment that they're in. So embryonic stem cells, which are those pluripotent stem cells I talked about, they have a lot of opportunity. Right now, we use them as an in vitro or in the bench method to understand development. Because they exist in these little balls, these are called embryonic masses, EBs, embryonic bodies, and we can get these cells, we can try to understand how we direct differentiation into different cells by studying these little balls in vitro. It turns out there's a really unique opportunity to understand rare diseases by this. As you may be aware, we have now developed a way so that you don't actually have to take those inner cell mass cells to make an embryonic stem cell. Instead, we can actually turn a skin cell into an embryonic stem cell by giving them the genes of stemness. And so this was actually developed by two scientists, one that is one of our professors here at UCSF, Dr. Yamanaka, and also a scientist in Wisconsin. And at the same time, they discovered these genes that you could put in cells and make them become embryonic stem cells. And I don't think I'm going to talk about them too much today, but what's amazing about that is you can take a skin cell from a rare disease patient, such as FOP, fibrodysplasia ossificans progressiva, tongue tie, so I always say FOP. And so it's a very rare disease, but it's a terrible disease where all of your tissues try to turn to bone. We have no models to study this disease, and it happens so rarely that it's really difficult to study the patients themselves. So we can use these skin cells, turn them into stem cells, and try to understand what mechanisms went wrong in these cells. And it's a really amazing opportunity. And they can differentiate into all cells of the body. So we can understand regeneration, and we can study regeneration of any organ. But there's some risks and some big challenges. I mentioned the ethical considerations and debate over use. So there are only a few lines available that are made available to research about, I think last I knew there were 13 lines that are available for research. And these, you know, they don't behave the same. They came from different sources. So there's some problems with that. We've overcome that quite a bit by using this technology where we can turn a skin cell into a stem cell. But we don't understand all the mechanisms to differentiate these cells, so we don't have a clear way. We really don't know how to get from here reliably to all of the different tissues we want to make. Usually we are trying to make bone, and we might make bone and cardiac and nerve at the same time, which is nice to study complex tissues, but if you're trying to understand a specific mechanism, we don't have the recipes worked out yet. They're really difficult to work with. These take 24-hour a day, 7-day a week monitoring. They're expensive. They're sort of a nightmare in the lab. And then teratoma formation, which is this picture, and it's that idea that we don't have a way to control them. So this is a picture of tissue that was formed from stem cells. It made cartilage, it made bone, it made nerve, it made a bunch of different things. And so basically, because we can't control them very well, they make these essentially tumors, which is a teratoma of all these different cell types. So there's a big risk for the fact that we don't know how to control their differentiation very well. So the adult stem cells are really where I think we have the most potential therapeutically to be using them And the advantage is that they too can be a model of repair and regeneration. They have much more established protocols for differentiation. It's so common now that you can get the recipe online for how to take a stem cell and turn it into a cartilage cell or a bone cell, and it happens pretty reliably. They can be found in the adult body in what we call the stem cell niches. So this is a schematic of what a stem cell niche is. This is your blood vessel. And then here is going to be some support cells, your stem cell. You have metabolic factors. You have the structural component. The nerve innervates this region. And they live in these parts of your body. And I'm going to go through what some of the stem cell niches are in the adult in a rather quiescent state. And then they can become active to either differentiate or proliferate based on signals from the blood, from the mechanical system. So you get a broken bone, for example, a nerve. All of these factors can help tell the stem cell what to do. So because it's interacting so closely with all these different areas, that's what regulates stem cells in the adult body. I also want to add that unlike the embryonic stem cells, which are very difficult to culture, these actually can be expanded in vitro in a petri dish very well for quite a while before they lose their stem cell state. It's not indefinite like a pluripotent stem cell, but they can go for multiple expansions before you start to see any issues. There are still some challenges. Dr. McLeod brought up a big one related to orthopedic surgery, but it's been really hard to, while we can take these stem cells and turn them into a bone cell or a chondrocyte, it's been really difficult to replicate the mechanical properties of the orthopedic tissue, which are so important. So while we can turn it into the right type of cell, we haven't figured out a way to build this entire structure, especially for cartilage, but also for bone. I'm going to talk about this in a little while, but as it turns out, age-related decrease in stem cell number also plays a role. So when you might need repair the most or when it's not working as well is when we have less stem cells, and that's probably an underlying reason for why we don't heal as well. As I mentioned, we've been able to turn the cell into the type of cell we want, but recreating this whole niche so that you can not only have the cartilage cells, but you can also have the stem cell embedded in there. So recreating the niche is a problem. And then where you get the stem cell out might have variable results in the differentiation. So I'll talk about that now. So skeletal stem cells, I'm going to start with those since it's our tissue of focus in this series here. I brought up earlier that skeletal stem cells can come from the bone marrow. So here I believe it's in green is the mesenchymal stem cell. So this is all in the bone marrow. You also have your hematopoietic stem cells. So bone marrow is the most classically described and best understood source of skeletal stem cells. But we've also now found that it's in the synovium, which is kind of the joint, the capsule surrounding the joint. Turns out it's in fat tissue. So, you know, I'm happy to donate stem cells anytime anybody needs them, come see me. In the periosteum, I talked about that previously. And pericytes, which are a cell that wraps around the blood vessel. And so this is one of the places that we can get stem cells into the circulating system really well because they basically live on the outside of blood vessels and can get into the blood vessel to circulate around. So the definition of a skeletal stem cell or mesenchymal stem cell is that it has to meet the ABCs. So it has to be able to form adipocytes, which are fat cells, bone cells, or osteocytes, chondrocytes, which are cartilage cells. So in order to be classified as a skeletal stem cell, you have to meet your ABCs. Some people still think that they can form stromal cells and tendon and ligament, but the classic definition is the ABCs. So these are the different sources I talked about and the skeletal lineage that has to be able to become. So one of the interesting questions has been, well, do all of these tissues make the same type of bone cartilage and fat cells? And what we've found out is that really, if you isolate stem cells from the bone marrow versus the fat, they both work they do things a little bit differently, and you actually have to use different recipes to differentiate the tissue. So it's still unknown, while we call them the same stem cell, really how similar they are to each other. People have also said that these MSCs, or skeletal stem cells, can go to other mesodermal tissues, such as skeletal muscle, smooth muscle, cardiac muscle, endothelial cells. I put a dotted line because I think we've now realized this probably isn't happening. There are even some reports on them becoming nerve cells and skin cells. The evidence supporting this data, this line of research, is even more questionable. So I put them up there because people have talked about them and there were reports that this has happened. But really, I think this is the only type of differentiation we see from the MSCs that's really well proven. But we do have other niches. So we have a skin stem cell niche. So you can see here is the hair shaft. And down at the bottom in this follicle is where you have the follicle here. And then there's this what's called the bulge. And this is the stem cell niche for the hair. And there's also this is the sebaceous gland. So these are all the tissues that are involved in a hair cell or a hair follicle. And here are the stem cells. And so people are actively doing research on understanding how these hair stem cells can be activated and what might go wrong. And you can imagine there's a huge market for understanding this. So there's some money behind it, but it's also very interesting that you can have this little pocket of stem cells here. Gut stem cells, the other kind of well-established niche that is a good example is in the gut. So this is the a high magnification of the intestine. And here is it in a schematic. And we found out that there's stem cells here. And people, this is really important because the gut can become injured in a number of different ways, and it's constantly regenerating itself. It can become injured both physically or just by eating something bad, antibiotics. You can lose some of the lining of the stem cells. And so the gut is constantly replacing itself, and we're now able to understand that so much better because of understanding where the stem cell niche is. So the bad news is the numbers decline with age. So this is a newborn. You have a lot of stem cells. By the time you're 80, your numbers are a lot lower. So these cells are rare. Even in an infant, there's still only 1 in 10,000, but you have a pretty good chance of getting some out of an infant. But as we go down, we have to have much better systems for isolating these cells. And so it's, you know, if somebody is just going to get an injection of stem cells and somebody comes by and says, look at all these stem cells I have. I got these out of your fat. Here's millions of stem cells. Well, that could be true, but these are a rare stem cell, and so it takes some expertise to actually isolate these stem cells and know that it's actually a stem cell. But the good news is we think that these mesenchymal stem cells are immunoprivileged and immunosuppressive. So this is a fancy schematic to basically show that we don't think they elicit what's called the graft versus host response. So you all know if you were going to get a kidney transplant, you'd have to go through a very elaborate testing to make sure you're a perfect match with the donor. It turns out that I could probably give my stem cells to any of you without you having a reaction. We think they're immunoprivileged. And we think part of the reason they're immunoprivileged is because they actively suppress the immune system. And in fact, the T cells, which are one of the cells that are involved in graft rejection, they can't activate a T cell response. So I think there is some real potential for this idea of stem cell banking, and maybe more excitingly, this idea of universal donors. So you all know with a blood transfusion, there's the universal donor. Well, we think that there could be a universal donor for mesenchymal stem cells, and ideally we could get these from a much younger stem cell source, and that those could be proliferated in vitro or expanded in vitro and then stored as a source. And there are some companies that are actively doing this sort of research. So hopefully you have a little bit better understanding of what a stem cell is. So let's think about how they could promote repair. So the MSC is what I'm going to focus on because those are our skeletal stem cells. So one thing we know they do is they secrete, which is they basically give out proteins and factors that are trophic. So basically that means they stimulate healing. So they stimulate healing and reduce fibrosis. And they, I guess this is actually how they reduce fibrosis, is they are anti-inflammatory. So this leads to modulating healing. We talked about earlier that it's really important to go from a pro-inflammatory to an anti-inflammatory state. So those are the two factors that we feel really good about what stem cells do, and I think have a lot of clinical potential. They also can differentiate into cartilage and bone. And so we can use these cells as a platform to growing new tissues or tissue engineering. So this first group is what we call paracrine stimulation, which basically means it's something the stem cells themselves are giving off to modulate healing. And this second group is how you would build a new tissue. So if we focus on some of the paracrine factors, they release all of these factors which stimulate healing. So you can see that these are a lot of things that are going to help cartilage and bone healing happen. So the stem cell isn't necessarily always turning into a chondrocyte or a bone cell, but it's promoting those bone cells and cartilage cells to start becoming more active. It also secretes some of the major and most effective anti-inflammatory cytokines or molecules. And I will talk about this a little bit more detail, but this is one of the few areas that's been very successfully used in clinical trials, is they've used stem cell lavages to treat graft versus host disease. And so basically you can give a whole bunch of these stem cells, and that has been much more effective than drugs in combating graft versus host when somebody is having a rejection from an organ. And I think it's because these cells are very nimble and responsive to the environment. So you're not just hitting it with an anti-inflammatory drug that's going to last for a whole for however long you're giving it at a dose that's probably super physiological. Instead, you're giving it, these cells know when to turn off and turn on depending on the environment. So these cells are sort of a much smarter drug potentially, and that is one area they've been effective in clinical trials. So this is the slide I showed earlier, but it turns out that these stem cells release these anti-inflammatory cytokines, so are really important in helping this switch from the pro to anti-inflammatory environment. So not only can your macrophages go wrong, but if your stem cells aren't activating this switch or polarization, that can be another dysfunction in healing. This is just a link or from a webpage, Osiris, which is one of the companies that is working on how to bank stem cells and how to develop stem cell-based therapies. But it just shows, again, that here you have in infants, when you get a response to healing, you don't have that much inflammation, your regeneration potential is huge, and you don't have that much scarring. In adults, we get a much more robust inflammation and robust and prolonged inflammation. Our regeneration isn't as good, and we get more of a scar. So the therapeutic potential of stem cells is that can we bring inflammation down, increase regeneration, and decrease fibrosis. So that's the promise of them. So the next question is then, how would you deliver stem cells? You can inject them. You could inject them a number of different ways. IP, so that would be, you know, giving a big shot in your stomach. You could have IV delivered stem cells, or you could inject them into a location of where you're having pain, your back, your knee, whatever. But then there become all these questions. So how do you inject them? How reliable is that? How fast should you inject them? Should you put something in with them? So this is an interesting statistic, and this is where I want everybody to be cautious about having stem cell injections. So people have done a lot of work to inject stem cells into the cardiac tissue, and this is where I said there were these reports that the stem cells, mesenchymal stem cells, were turning into cardiac cells. And the reason is because people thought people found an improvement in cardiac function when you gave an injection of stem cells, mesenchymal stem cells. But it turns out, as they looked at this more, that only 10% of the cells survive more than 24 hours, and only 1.4% of them remained at the site of injection. So only 1.4% of them grafted into the heart. So they thought, oh my gosh, I'm injecting mesenchymal stem cells. They're turning into cardiac cells. This is huge. Well, probably what they were doing is they were encouraging the native heart tissue to start responding and regenerating. And then, are we at 8:30? Oh, sorry, I'm going to wrap up because we're our program needs to cut off. So I'm going to go quickly through this last part. So the stem cells weren't staying there. They were didn't turn into heart cells. They just encouraged the native response. It turns out if you inject these cells too quickly, you'll kill all the cells. And if you don't put them in something viscous, you'll also kill all these cells. So somebody that hasn't taken into consideration all of these factors probably doesn't understand stem cell biology very well. Okay. In the interest of time, I'm going to actually go towards the end of the conclusions. I think the one last area I'll bring up is there is this effort of doing stem cell, using stem cells to engineer the tissues. And Dr. McLeod brought up a very important point on this, and that is that our challenge here is not necessarily turning them into cartilage cells or bone cells, but actually giving them in a matrix that can support the physical load that these orthopedic tissues require. So we're doing this by developing scaffolds that deliver growth factors, look like the native tissue, are biodegradable, and will best mimic the niche. And we've made a lot of progress on these, but we're not really to the point that these are translating to the clinic right now. So how close are we? You could have skipped the whole lecture. I could have just told you at the beginning that we're 5 years out. The caveat is I've been saying 5 years for 8 years, so hopefully in 5 years I won't tell you again that they're 5 years out, because we have made some significant strides. We've understood their anti-inflammatory role. They're in, the recent statistic I saw was 160 clinical trials across the country. And so I think we're getting much closer, and there's a huge number of there's a huge amount of potential, but there's still quite a bit of concern. So I really caution anybody against unregulated off-label use of these cells. It's certainly not something that if someone says, "Oh, sure, I can inject stem cells. You just have to pay me this much money," you should do. This is happening all over in other countries, and while there've been some remarkable breakthrough cases, by and large, people are basically wasting their money. But we have a lot of work to do to make this a more regulated process and understand manufacturing and long-term safety and efficacy. But I think we've made a lot of strides, and we are in the end stages of clinical trials. And as I emphasized earlier, that's why research takes a long time, but also why we can have evidence-based medicine that's going to lead to results that we can understand. So. Sorry, I'll end there.